art the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. Jesus answered, it is written, man does not live on bread alone. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me. And I can give it to you anyone I want to. So if you worship me, it will be all yours. Jesus answered, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, and notice the devil is quoting the Bible, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands, said, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered, it says, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. But very interesting that ending, he left him until an opportune time. Because these three temptations come again and again and again. When he feeds the crowds, the same temptation comes. When he enters Jerusalem, the same temptation comes, they want to make him king. And it's interesting that, in a way, these three temptations summarize what Jesus goes through throughout his ministry. Well, I intentionally had the title kind of nebulous on your bulletins. It says 40 days, so that it will awaken your imagination, I'm sure. Those of us that come from Musada will think of 40 days of Musada. Well, by the way, do you know that the hero, the leader of the rebellion of the Musada, Reverend Andreasian's daughter, is among us? We are honored. But I'm not talking about the 40 days of Musada, nor the 40 days and 40 nights of Noah. Flood. The focus is on Jesus spending 40 days in the desert. According to the ecclesiastical, to church calendar, this Sunday is the first Sunday of Lent. It's the first Sunday of fasting, self-discipline, of sacrifice, and repentance. Now, in our churches, unfortunately, evangelical churches, we do not adhere to keeping this Lenten season. I honestly think it's a very good thing. Because we human beings are lazy. We like to postpone everything. So if you have it scheduled during the year, during the church year, it gives us an opportunity to reflect on our life. The early church fathers understood becoming a Christian, that meant a new life, entering a new life, taking a new orientation. And very often, they would get new names. People that are baptized, they will receive a new name, a Christian name. But the early church fathers also changed the calendar. They wanted to create a new time frame whose center is Jesus. So you have the year divided into four major parts. The first is the Advent. We get ready for the birth of Christ. Then comes Lenten, in which you're preparing for Easter. Then comes Pentecost, which you prepare for the coming of the Holy Spirit. And the period from Pentecost until the Lenten is the church's year. That's when we remember the saints and the prophets and so on. Thus, Advent prepares us to celebrate, Lenten prepares us to celebrate the Easter. During the 40 days of Lent, the believer is engaged in self-examination. Self-denial, that's how we go into not eating meat. Spiritual growth, it's a period of cleansing out those things which hinder us from communication with God and with our fellow men. It is a season of transformation, of becoming like Christ. Saint Athanasius, by the way, who is the behind the Nicene Creed, spoke thus on this period. He said, becoming by grace what God is by nature. In Lenten season, we become by grace what God is by nature. Now, every vision has a mission, folks. So Jesus, as he was being baptized, he saw the vision, the dove coming down. He heard the voice that said, "You are my son. With thee I am well pleased." But what does this mean? Jesus is directed by the Holy Spirit into the desert to consider his mission. The desert had a special meaning for the ancient church fathers, by the way. If you go into church history, you'll see that the early monks started in the desert. They went into the desert because there was a strong belief that the desert was the citadel, was the stronghold of the devil. If you can go into the desert, live by yourself, survive hunger, depression, by the way, it came. There's no human contact. There's the danger of being attacked by wild animals, and that used to happen a lot, and that's why then they changed them from being monks that lived by themselves to at least two monks together, because the natural dangers was too much. So if you go to the desert and you survive all these, then you are really considered a purified, committed monk. Then you come back and serve the church. And in the New Testament you have this. The desert is where the devil is. So with the baptism began his God-ordained ministry. He's ordained now. But now he had to decide, what was he going to do? What exactly God's will for him involved? What was going to be his focus? How was he going to reach the people of his time? They were oppressed. They were in economic deprivation. They were under the foot of the Roman soldiers. What was going to be his ministry to these people? So at the end of the 40 days, it says, the tempter approached him and asked him the obvious question. You're hungry. People are hungry. Change these stones into bread and people, and you will eat and people will be happy. He was hungry. And his experience of hunger could have reminded him of the hunger of his people. After all, he was poor, He knew what it means to go to bed in an empty stomach. Meeting people's basic need could gain him great popularity. Dostoevsky, in The Brothers Karamazov, reworks this scene. When Jesus appears suddenly in the 17th century in Spain, and he comes into the cathedral court, the Grand Inquisitor meets him. And this scene of changing stones into bread is worked out. The Grand Inquisitor, I'm quoting. "And do you see the stones in this parched and barren desert? Turn them into loaves, and mankind will run after you like a flock of sheep, grateful and obedient." But you did not want to deprive man of freedom, and rejected the offer, for you thought, what sort of freedom is it if obedience is bought with loaves of bread? Feeding people is good, folks. But it is not the highest good. Thus, Jesus' response was, as you all know it very well, man shall not live by bread alone. Here, Jesus rejects the option of becoming a social reformer who dedicates his life to the eradication of hunger and poverty. Why did Jesus do that? Didn't he really care for all these hungry people? Because he believed a human being is not just an animal that eats and procreates. Man has a soul, a consciousness that cannot be satisfied by mere existence. We as human beings, we look for meaning. What is the meaning of my life? Is life suffering worth living for? What is worth dying for? We look for a roadmap. We're born into this world, but how are we going to live? What standards do we abide by? How are we going to relate to people around us? We ask questions about our future. Is the official thing that we say at the grave, earth you are, to earth you shall return, or ashes to ashes? You know, that is the official teaching of Judaism. And it's interesting, we repeat it every time we go to the grave. Ashes to ashes is the end, according to Judaic teaching, according to the Old Testament too. They did not believe in life after death. You remember when Jesus was approached with the parable of the woman who married her seven brothers. Whose wife was she going to be? Why did they bring that story to him? To show him that believing in life after death was stupid. So is really, you die, it's finished? Or is there another life after death? These questions and the answers provide the bread for our souls, which yearn in our loneliness for the faith that binds us to God, for the love that binds us to each other, and for the hope of a life in the future. Jesus had to decide whether to meet the hunger of the body for bread, or the hunger of the soul for God. After thinking, he concludes, man shall not live by bread alone. Notice, he's not denying the bread's need. The body needs the bread. He said, just by bread alone. In John 4:34, Jesus defines really his food. He says, my food is to do the will of Him who sent me and to accomplish His work. My food is to do the will of Him who sent me and accomplish His work. So the first temptation, which he rejected, was about the role of economic reformer. And the second temptation had to be a choice, whether to become a political messiah who would satisfy the patriotic aspirations of his people. So the devil shows him the kingdoms of the world and tells him, I will give you all this if you would worship me. It shall be yours, it says. Now, don't think the devil's offer was not realistic. And it was timely. Israel and the entire Mediterranean world were under the foot of the Romans. Everybody wanted freedom. They yearned for freedom. Their bodies and their souls were oppressed. So becoming a political leader, he would liberate all these people. Look, if Hitler, with all his stupidity, was almost conquering all of Europe, you think it's impossible for somebody like Jesus to conquer the Romans if he raised a rebellion against them? It was possible. But Jesus remained focused. In spite of being tired and hungry, he rejected the power. Jesus' answer was, you shall worship the Lord your God, and Him alone shall you serve. Few remember, last time I preached was a year ago about worship. Worship really is the ultimate question for human beings. Whom do you worship? Who is the center of your life? And if you recall, at that time, I spoke about the Persian word and the Armenian word bashtel, which comes from the Persian parisht, which means to stand around. What is the focus of your life? Who is the center of my life? Is it me? Is it my ability? What people think of me? Is it my wealth? It's good to think about these things at this Lenten period. Who is the focus of your life? I'm sure some of you have heard the big news of this week. This lady that was the former mayor of San Diego, the wife of the owner of Jack in the Box, who when he died left her $40 million. And what did she do with the $40 million? She liked gambling. She lost all $40 million and got desperate enough that she borrowed $2 million from a foundation that he had and misused that too. And now she doesn't even have a home to stay, so she lives with her sister. And lots of people are asking for their monies. For this woman, gambling was the center of her life. So who is the center of your life? Whom do we worship is really the ultimate question. Very often we have problems in our church because we pursue our agenda. We want to use the church for our own purpose, for our aggrandizement, self-aggrandizement, for promoting ourselves, our ideas. But does the church really belong to any one of us? We are here to worship God by word and action. And the action involves two things: giving your time. You know, I suffer every year in December coming and asking you guys to serve on the church council. And I get more rejections than acceptance. Sacrifice is sacrifice. Giving time for the church, for God, is your duty. The second thing, today our chairman will come and distribute the pledge cards. We are about 41 members in this church. Only we receive 20 cards? Why not all of you? Why do you run your business like that? You don't set a budget? Why do you expect God's business to be run high Allah, as we say in Armenian and Arabic? Why? What's the logic? We all have to give from our means, whatever we can. Make a promise, tell God, even if you don't, I'm not sure you'll have that much money. At least say, I wish I can give this much money. But make a pledge. Well, I emptied my heart, I guess. So we move on to the third temptation. The third temptation was the supreme temptation. By the way, interesting, Mark and Matthew do not have the same order. Luke changed the order. Mark doesn't mention the temptations, he just was tempted. But Luke changed the order. And rightly so. The third temptation is where untruth was disguised as truth. Oh, okay, Jesus, I'm talking like the devil. You are the Son of God. Don't you want to be sure that you did not hear an imaginary voice from an imaginary father? And the devil, by the way, as I mentioned, knows the scripture very well. So he quotes Psalm 91, verses 11 and 12, to prove his point. So he tells Jesus, come on, Jesus, test the waters by just jumping off this high pinnacle or wall in Jerusalem. You know what? If you are really the Son of God, God loves you. He will send his protecting angel and they will lift you up and nothing will happen to you. Just make sure that what you heard is real. It seems possible that Jesus would have believed this. Like many Christians who believe that God takes care of them, protects them. If you are a good person, you will have a protecting angel on your side. Nothing will happen to you. But Jesus sees through the supreme temptation. If faith in God means wholehearted trust, then putting God to test is the supreme sign of unbelief. For Jesus, faith meant submission to God's will, a submission that culminates in his death on the cross. I'm coming to my end. As we start this special season of fasting, self-discipline, sacrifice, and self-examination, let's focus on these three temptations and see if any area of our life needs to be transformed. First, man does not live by bread alone. Jesus does not deny the need for food, for matter. But it is not everything. Above our lives and possessions stands God in his wisdom and love. Second, the focus of a person's worship should be God and not power, or whatever we choose. You can choose sex. And this reminds me of the big news of this week. What's the big news of this week? The church news. The Pope, good. The resignation of the Pope. Focus, folks, this resignation is very, very exemplary. The Pope, I cannot say he's stronger than President Obama. He doesn't have that much army. But he is the strongest man. He represents God. When the Pope sits on his throne and speaks, that is the word of God. And this man, with all this power, for 600-700 years, nobody has resigned on the throne, decided, I am human, I'm limited, I can't do my function. His resignation is really an example of humility for the rest of us, that we are limited. God is the center. And the third point, do not waver in your faith. Temptations, suffering, illness comes, and these are not easy things. I know it, I've been in it in this last month. But keep your trust anchored in the source of our life, source of our salvation, and our hope for the future. May the Lord bless his word.